Okay, today I am going to put all my disappointments aside and record changing the coils. I've already changed them, and somebody asked me to make a video on the ignition coils, and this is a bit of a sore subject with a lot of people. But anyway, I have the original coils out. I'll turn them this way, I guess, the way they're supposed to be. So if you're standing at the front of the bike, and I had to cover off, and you were pretty much sitting right in the front wheel, looking back towards the back of the bike, this is the way the coils would be sitting. And there's definitely a left and a right. I've hauled them out before because I was troubleshooting them. These coils, they work, but they've lost, I don't know whether or not they're just the HT leads are corroding, but there's some corrosion. But anyway, there's not a very strong spark. And I've replaced everything else. And of course, the coils that are in there now, I'll show what's going on here. I got some issues with those ones, but had quite a bit of quite a bit of bad luck. These, of course, are Yamaha ones, and you can see that they're there's definitely a right and a left, and right rear, left front cylinder, and they're mirror images of each other. And the reason why is because where they mount these connectors clear the mounting bar. There's a mounting bar here in the front of the frame. So if you look at these, there's two connectors. There's they're not quite the same size either. I don't know if you can see this or not, but I'll put one down. But so the rear little rubber thing here mounts in the back, and then this coil goes along. This would go along the frame back to the rear cylinder. So there's two connections on each one. They share a 12 volt power, which is on the top. This is 12 volts, that 12 volts. It's a red wire with a white stripe on it, I think. Anyway, they're ganged together back behind the loom somewhere. And then for the from the TCI unit, the ignition unit, there's where the connection is for the left and the right. One's gray, one's orange. I don't recall off the top of my head right which ones they are. I'll throw a schematic up and you have a look at it. But so essentially what happens with the coils is they're current limited devices, and I'll talk about that later. But they're powered up, and then the TCI, what happens is the TCI will obviously get a signal from the coil pickups and compensate for vacuum as well through the sensor. And what it does is you have 12 volts, which is on all the time, and then 12 volts here, and then the TCU will go to ground. And the minute it goes to ground on the primaries, the secondaries will try to go to infinity, which they can't, obviously, the voltage, that is. And when the field collapses on the primary side, it's inversely proportional on the secondary. So as the primary winding goes to zero or approaches zero, let's use calculus to figure that out, the secondary windings will try to go to infinity. That's what's connected to the secondary windings, of course, with a spark plug cap on there. And of course, it ends up being, if you measure it out, scope it out, it's usually sitting around anywhere for a good spark on the HT lead is somewhere maybe 20,000 volts for these bikes and these type of coils. They can be higher, of course, 50,000 in a sports car or something like that, or high performance race car. But there's an ongoing saga with these old bikes, getting into the plugs and getting into the caps, and I'll talk about that later. But for now, all we're doing here is we're trying to find these. I don't know how many times I've been so disappointed trying to buy them. This came from one vendor, and as you can see, it's not the right one. They were the same length, clearly not even the same plug. But the photos, when I ordered it, they look just like this. Of course, that's what I got in the mail, and not even close to the original Virago ones. There's no schematic, so I don't know how this is set up, but probably just 12 volts, and then it just goes to ground, like a set of contacts with the points, or a TCI would drop this to ground, and you'd get, and in that case, you'd have to have power Or these would be grounded here, one of the two. Like I said, I'm not sure what these are, but these will not work. So I ordered another set. I'll pull those out and show you. But what ended up happening, they look the same contact. This stud here is isolated on the Viragos. There's no connection whatsoever, no electrical connection, not even ground. So it's completely isolated from these two connections and the output. But the new ones that I bought, and I'll show them to you here in a minute. They have a connector on the side. You'll notice that these are short, and that gives you room to put the mounting screw in. But the other ones come out here on the bottom, and I ended up mounting them upside down. And of course, now the cap doesn't go on. But I'll show you all that. I'll pull them out, and then we'll wire them back up and put them in and show you how I install these things. The front one's pretty easy because it just goes around, it gets mounted, and this goes around to the front plug, and the caps just screw in here. But the back one's a bit of a trick to get at the back spark plug. So I just keep a little bit of spark plug wire handy, and because you got to fish it across the top of the carburetors, all the way from the rear cylinder. So what I do is I'll just tape this, and as I pull this one out, this gets fished through the hole. And you'll see, I'll show it on the bike here in a second. And this gets hanging out, and then I'll put the new one in, tape the new one to this, and then pull it through. And I'll show you now. But anyway, these are the two original ones. They're still functioning, but they're a very weak spark. And again, the rear one, when the rubber breaks down, they'll end up, you can have arcing against the frame. And it can show up as all kinds of problems. And of course, if you arc, it won't get a spark. And if it doesn't get a spark, plugs will foul. It looks like a carburetor problem. In fact, it's not. So let's go have a look at the bike. I'll show you where they're mounted. So that's where the coils are mounted. Just gonna tap the GoPro on to see where I'm pointing. Yeah, so that's where they're mounted. And you can see I got one screw in here, but there's a second one, and the reason why this is sitting up here like this all cockeyed, that's not how it fits properly. But that's the pressure sensor right there. It goes back, senses vacuum coming off the front cylinder carburetor, and the mixture control valve. And then there's a little sensor in here that converts that vacuum to an electrical voltage. And that voltage is sensed at the TCU, and that's what adjusts timing on these bikes. So this cap is going to come off. There's a screw in the bottom, usually a short one and a long one, and this will come off. I'll show you the coils I have on here, and then we'll the whole idea here is I'm going to pull these out, try to mount them properly so this thing fits properly, and talk about some of the trials that you'll come across, and just some tips to make it a little bit easier, and just some diagnostics as well. All right, so I will take some photographs of this. I'll put this connection back on. Let's see, I might have to move it. Oh, there we go. That's gonna work out just fine. All right, so the red power wire goes here. I might have to move that around as well. And then the ignition connection goes on that terminal right there. So there is clearance. It doesn't look like there's a lot. It's enough. Certainly helps out. But anyways, I'm gonna take my phone camera and I will take some video. All right, so I'm gonna sort of sweep underneath here and have a look. You can see what the clearance is there. So there's plenty of clearance. And there's no risk of those ignition wires touching the frame. But what I am concerned with is this cap going back on. And we'll see if that happens or if there's a problem. But the bottom of the cap fits right here. And yeah, I think that'll work.
So it's mounted, and you can see why I had to put those washers up here, because I didn't want the screw, the end of the screw, coming through here and touching this connection, or coming anywhere near it. So everything's got clearance, everything's in there, they're mounted the correct way, and when they were upside down, they were, again, they're electrically, they're functioning well. I was really surprised, and I noticed a difference right away from the old coils to the new ones, and oddly enough, the resistance was the same, but the performance was nowhere near the same. And I'll talk about that here a little bit more here in a moment. But anyway, physically they're in there. I'm going to put the hose back on the vacuum line right there. I'm gonna put that vacuum line back on and get everything buttoned back up. And then what I'll do is I'll go on the bench and we'll test the other coils, and I'll show you what I'm talking about when it comes to the caps and the spark plugs and all that stuff. All right. Yeah, I don't think you need, well, I'll leave the camera running. I'll turn the phone one off, but yeah, and I'll see if I can get this, the cap back on properly. To make sure this is going to fit, because it wouldn't fit before with the caps upside down, and I just wanted to get them on and, you know, and give it a test run. So I can see that from here, that's the longer screw up at the top, and let's see if I can, whoops, is it still recording? Nope. All right, so longer screw up at the top with the vacuum line in place, and it'll clamp, and then the shorter screw down to the bottom, and that cover pretty much just, it's just there to keep the moisture and dirt and crap off the coils, because of the heat from the engine and all the, there is some oil and grease and stuff that makes its way up there. It's a good idea to pull it off every once in a while and clean it. And that's that. So what I have here, all right, so out here I've got the coil wire coming through here, and these, you just cut them the length, and then you thread the cap in, and leave yourself a little extra room because these things wear out. And so that'll be the front. I'll put the cap on here in a moment, and then of course the back. All right, so there's the wire coming back from the front, the right coil, yeah, rear, and you can see there's where the, I don't know if you can see it or not, these things don't focus very well when they're up. Anyway, there's the heat shield, and there's where I taped it. Getting the big picture, if you can kind of see this, then you'll get an idea of what I've done here. So this originally, it'll go outside of the oil line here. And then I'll take the tape off, talk about the caps and the plugs here in a second. And then we'll, just gonna make some measurements with my meter. That way you can see what I'm talking about. Okay, what we're gonna do here now is we're gonna measure the coils. These are the originals. And hopefully I'll be able to, I think I have a good description of how the coils are wired. Just like just a layman's, what you can expect. So like I mentioned, you have a primary winding and you have a secondary winding. It's a transformer is all it is. And back in my electronic theory days, transformer theory is kind of interesting. You have so many coils on one side, or so many windings of wire on one side and so many windings on the other. And if the size of the wire is the same, and you put 10 windings on one and 20 on the other, if you put, you know, whatever, 1 volt on here, whatever the ratio is, it'll, you know, 2 to 1, let's say, then it'll be 2 volts on here. Transformers only pass AC. So if you put a battery on here and you try to measure voltage, nothing's going to happen. But remember that a change, or it doesn't matter what the rate of change is, it can be instantaneous
or it can be a period, like a cycle, like 60 hertz or something like that. It'll pass it very well. So if you hook this up, if it's in this case, you've got a very heavy copper wire on one side with very few windings. And it's not a very long piece of wire. It's just a short piece of wire wrapped around the coil on the primary side. And then on the secondary side, it's very fine wire. And it's wrapped literally thousands and thousands and thousands of times, hence the high voltage. So the current won't change. They're current limited devices. But the voltage will change dramatically. And what the coils are doing is, like I said, you cannot pass DC through a transformer, or a coil in this case, same thing. But what constitutes alternating current is just a rate of change over time. So if you take voltage away or put voltage on, that's a change. And you'll sense that on the secondaries of a coil. Same thing with a transformer. So in this case, these coils, don't know what the ratios are, it doesn't matter, but basically what's happening is there's 12 volts, you have a trigger, it collapses the field, it goes the way, it goes to ground, field collapses on one side, and they're inversely proportional too, by the way, so as one goes down, the other one goes up, and vice versa. So as this one goes down, that one goes up, high voltage will be sensed on the secondaries. There is a spec in the manual, and you're obviously, on the primaries, you're going to sense a much smaller resistance because it's a small, heavy, thick copper wire. It's gonna be very little resistance in there. On the secondary, it's a long wire, obviously wrapped many, many times long, thin wire, it's gonna be higher resistance. Now, the manual specs, I believe it's something like 12K or something like 12,000 ohms, which is 12 kilo ohms. So you'll go up to the next setting on your meter, there's 200, 2000, can't measure, 12,000 ohms with a 2K. So up to 20 would be the next biggest setting. So what I'll do is, just by the design of these coils, I'll just shove this in here. And these two are tied together, I'll try to show that in a diagram. But anyways, if I measure them here, I'm seeing about 13K, which is within spec. Now, if you measure this, if you just put this on here with the connection on it, you're measuring also the resistance of whatever's attached to it in parallel. So don't do that. Pull the connection off completely and measure these like this. So that's within spec. But again, the coil's just not performing because it's corroded or something, or whatever the case may be. It's just not performing, but it's in spec. So still always be suspect of these. These NGK caps, this is an LB01EP. LB is the angle, the length. The 01 is, it's a 1K ohm resistor in here. And then the EP, I don't know if you can see it or not, but there's the plug. It's just the plug type, the way it connects to the plug, whether it's threaded or whether it's a nut on the top of it. And I prefer the nut because it's just a bigger surface area. So you spec these out. You can find these anywhere. So 13K is good. If you go across from the primary and secondary, you should be able to get about the same thing on the second terminal. So you're still measuring the secondary windings. And again, I'll show you that diagram here in a minute, or I'll put it up or whatever the case may be. So that's that. That's within spec. If you want to measure the primary is only like 4 ohms. So you got to go down to the lowest setting. I'll set it to 200. And I'll put, I'll put the meter across the primary windings, and I get about 4.5 ohms. And that's the right way to measure these. Like I said, you can't measure these with something connected to them. You're gonna get a wrong reading. So the connections, any connections have to be removed. The other thing you got to be really careful of too is don't put your fingers on these when you're measuring resistance, because you're going to put your body in parallel. So just don't do that. Try not to. And of course, obviously, try not to. But that's like I said, that's in spec. But again, they're breaking down, the wire's getting corroded, whatever the case may be, these are not performing. And all I did to check was I just looked at the spark plug, but pulled them out, grounded the spark plug out. And, if you need to have a bright blue spark that's visible, you should be able to hear it. Anything less than that, either your coils or the leads. And unfortunately these are bonded in here. If you just got bad leads, sometimes you can just buy new leads and make a connection, plug them in. But these OEM Virago ones, They're bonded in. So it's been a bit of a contentious issue with a lot of people now because, the bikes are getting older and it's harder and harder to find these. And like I showed you, I thought I found the right ones, but they had the connections in the wrong place. This piece of garbage, I don't know, comes off like a lawnmower or something. I don't know where that is or where it came from. Certainly not the right product. But anyways, let's measure the cap while I'm at it. These are LB01, so 01, 1K, 1,000 ohms. The OEM ones, the ones that came with the bike, were 5,000, and I'll talk about that here in a second. So, nope, I need 20K to measure that. And so there we go. That's a 1K ohm cap there. So there's a 1,000 ohm resistor in here. That's a spring. I think this one must be bonded in. Some of them you can get out, some of them you can't. But so this is the same heat index plug that came with the Virago BPR70S. 7 is the heat index. So I'll talk about the plug real quick. B, I think it's the length of the shaft here. P is protruding, which is the inside terminal protrudes down through the plug. And if you don't have a P, then this isn't going to reach out far enough and you won't get proper combustion. R means resistor, typically 5 kilo ohms, 5,000 ohms in this plug. And 7 is the heat index, and ES, I'm not sure what the ES means, but anyway, there's a chart for that too. But here's the nut that I like to keep on, and this cap matches that nut. The problem is the original plugs that came with the Yamaha Viragos, most of them anyways, were BP70S, non-resistor type. So when you have a cap plug combination like this, and it was 5 kilo ohms here and none here, well then you got the coil resistance, the 5K, and then nothing. And that's just a resistive, a series resistive circuit, right? So you got the resistance of the coils and the leads, which was what we measured to be 13K, plus another 5, so whatever that is, 18K. And then again, if you have this plug and not the original one, which they're almost impossible to find these days, there's another 5K. Now, the formula for current, IZ over R, the current is limited, voltage is E, R is resistance. So as the resistance increases, the voltage is gonna decrease. So the more resistance you have in the circuit, in a series a circuit, the lower the voltage is gonna be. There's gonna be a greater voltage drop. And you can see that just with the color of the plug, the color of the spark. So if you can't find a non-resistor plug for your Virago, which is what you need, if you have the original caps, 5K, then you've got to, and you find a, this plug here, the BPR70S, which is fine, it's proper heat index and everything. 5K in here or 5K in here, but not both, because 10K is too much. You're going to get too much of a voltage drop and you're going to have plug fouling. It's going to be, it'll misfire. You'll have one, you won't have a good strong combustion. You'll have a cycle where it doesn't ignite. The next cycle it may, and now you got backfiring and you've got plug fouling and it'll look like you got a carburetor issue, and in fact you don't have the proper system voltage that the bike was designed for, which is the 13K plus the 5 and then no resistor in the plug. So all I've done is I've gone to lower resistance in the cap, 1K is fine, and a standard BPR70S plug. Proper heat index, proper plug, and you're back to nominal resistance in the circuit. So hopefully that makes sense. I'll draw it out, or I'll try to get something up there. Like I said, this is a pretty contentious issue because I don't think a lot of people understand just the basic electronic theory. And you don't need a resistor plug, and you don't need a resistor in the cap. Resistors are in ignition systems to suppress RF noise, no other reason. And again, the more resistance you have, the less voltage you're going to have. Less voltage is a weaker spark. That's just It's just physics. You can't argue against that. That's just the way it works. So that's a good combination. I found I've worked with these now and tested them, and they work great. I've switched out the BPR70S to the NGK plugs, the Iridiums, that have a slightly smaller, just a finer tip in them. I find I get a much more intense spark, and they work better. I find I can tell right away the performance is much better. So these are the caps. I'm going to screw these in, and that's all it is. They just literally, I'll do it here so you can see. But let's see, I think there's a rubber little rubber cover as well that comes with these. There it is. So what you'll end up doing is you put these on the wire, you push them back out of the way, you screw these in just like this. And these are waterproof. These have nice, soft, supple rubber plugs on them, or rubber covers on them. Okay, so what you'll be doing here when you get the cap threaded in is just adding a little bit of dielectric grease, and you just rub it along the outside of this connection right here, and then plug that back down in there. And it'll actually probably put some on the wire as well. That'll keep this. Yeah, put some on the wire right here. Put some on here. They're not for electrical connections. They're to seal it out and keep the voltage from arcing, because it's high voltage. So that'll be done. That'll be considered finished when I put this back on my bike. And then once it's all done, I will just literally I just hit the starter button, and it should fire right up right away. And yeah, that's it. So this is what you're looking for. This is just a local. I think this is Permatex dielectric grease. Little small little tube will last forever, but they're great anytime you have rubber connections, you know, or in a connector where you need a little bit of waterproofing or some protection from the elements. So that's that. Let's see, is there anything else I need to talk about? This whole thing, the whole ignition system, is pretty simple, but at the same time, you know, everything has to be working properly together. The coils have to be in good shape. The HT leads, they've got to be in good condition. These are corroded like crazy. So, you know, this isn't going to work. And you can cut them back, and you can. You can cut them back anytime you want. If there's any corrosion, you cut a, you know, half an inch off or whatever you need, and then just screw the cap back in. Unscrew them, cut it, screw the cap back in. But eventually you're going to run out. and that's the problem. And of course, like I said, they're bonded in. You got to replace the whole thing. In a pinch, you can, you know, there's, I think NGK actually makes a little splicer. You know, you can find some cable, splice it, you know, pull it back a little bit, or even pull it right back to here and put some new wire on. That would be an interim fix to get you home or something like that, but certainly not a long-term fix. And it will work. The other thing I've seen is the wire on the back one, especially, like I said, it runs the length of the frame. And it's very close to the top of the cylinders, very close to the carburetors, very close to the frame. And if this rubber starts to break down for whatever reason, it'll arc to the frame. And every time it arcs to the frame, it isn't going to the spark plug. And that will be, again, a misfire followed by a backfire, probably, because you get all that unburned fuel in the cylinder. Second cycle comes around and boom, off she goes. So that's that. I'll finish up mine. I'll put the caps on, and then we'll give it a quick start and just make sure everything works.
Okay, moment of truth. I got the coils installed and properly oriented, the cables properly routed. Mounting screws, the long one in the top, short one in the bottom, and the vacuum line is connected. Properly run. Let's see. Yeah, so this is, I think that wire is actually a little bit long, but I'll just sort of tuck it out of the way here in a minute. But I just wanted to make sure everything's working. So there's the cap and plug. Now I'm running the Iridium plugs in here. There's still a BPR7 plug. So same physical size, same protruding, same heat index at 7 heat index.
But the EIX is the iridium, which has got a slightly better material, and it just makes for a more intense spark, and it's more concentrated spark just because of the size of the little terminal at the end, the electrode. So that's what I'm running there. There's the NGK caps, 1K cap, new brand new wires. I'll tuck that out of the way before I start it. Okay, so that's on. Tack looks good, no jumping around. That'll be a good sign if you get the wires reversed or something. And we'll start it up. Great, cool. All right, so post-edit, wasn't feeling good with the way those wires were close to the frame, so I pulled the cover off and I put some, I have some heat shrink tubing here. This stuff right here, it's an intermelt. It's got glue on the inside. Anyway, I cut a couple small pieces of the heat shrink tubing and put it over the connectors where these are a little bit longer than the stock ones. Again, like I said, the OEM ones. So we can see this here in a second. Yeah, so the OEM plugs are connectors are obviously, like I showed you, they're in different places, but they're also, yeah, again, camera won't focus here, but anyway, they're shorter. The ones that I bought that are in the bike now are longer in the wrong location. So what I ended up doing was I just put some, because they protrude so far out, out about almost twice the length. So I just covered the part that was closest to the body here in that heat shrink tubing and bent them up a little bit differently, and then put some more spacers on the mounts to keep them away from the any metal on the frame. So that's done. Gives me a little bit of peace of mind. Again, you know, so hard to find the OEM ones. Yeah. So these are what I bought. I bought an extra set. I saw them actually today, LB01EP. And again, the code just talks about, you know, what the inside is, the resistor and the shape and all that stuff. So I think the P or the EP is the waterproof. This is a waterproof version of it, so I got this one. They're only $4, $5, so they're really, really good quality product. So that's that. That's the two coils replaced. That's the new caps, new spark plugs. Everything's all tested out. The cover's back in place where it's supposed to be, properly mounted now and everything like that. So pretty happy with that. I'll mess around with the routing of the wire and I'll make sure it gets in there the right way. But I gave myself a little extra too for those times where I need to cut it back when it corrodes. And hopefully those coils will last a while. All right, so that's the end of this one. Like I said, I've already taken the bike out for a test ride, and I can, you know, it's a noticeable improvement, a noticeable change. The color of the spark, the sound of the spark, and just the way the throttle response. Everything I do to the bike, it just keeps getting better and better. You know, the carb's been overhauled, and the fuel system cleaned out, and now the ignition system. And the valves adjusted, all this. I mean, it all adds up, makes a huge difference. Today when I was out riding, you know, just crisp, strong throttle response and good pull, good torque all the way up, you know, to highway speeds without any hesitation whatsoever. So pretty happy with this. Yeah, so I just wanted to share, you know, the information, and if it helps people out, that's great. So any questions, any comments, be happy to answer them. You just comment below and I'll get back to you. You got a Virago and you're working on it. Hope you're having fun and hoping you enjoy it. They're a great old nostalgia bike and I love them. All right, cheers.